In the name of Allah, who came to us in the person of Master Farad Muhammad, we thank him for his coming and raising up in our midst a divine leader, teacher, and guide in the personage of the Most Honorable Elijah Muhammad. And we can never ever thank him enough for giving us today a divine leader, a teacher, a guide, and a wonderful example. I speak of none other than the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan. I greet all of you in the greeting words of peace in the Arabic language, Assalamu Alaikum. Dear brothers and sisters, we are very happy that today Allah has blessed us, that our leader took us to Ghana 2 weeks ago to fulfill the vision of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, Marcus Garvey, and others, the vision and the idea that God had for us. And we thank Allah for blessing him to take us there, and we thank Allah for blessing all of us to return safely to our places of abode. But today we are overexcited because he comes to speak to us here in Chicago. All praises due to Allah. As we prepare to receive our beloved minister, I would like to draw you to an important point that Brother Farrakhan made in his address in Ghana, which is the entire context of the address is found in the recent edition of The Final Call. And as we emphasize and re-emphasize the importance and the value of leadership, please pay note to these words. The most important ingredient in leadership is not economic know-how. It is not political sagacity. It is not psychoanalytical powers. It is not historical perspective. It is not even science, mathematics, chemistry, and technology. The most important ingredient in leadership is vision. The Bible says where there is no vision, the people perish. We are coming alive today because at the root of the vision that we are fulfilling is the idea. And the idea comes from God, which brings up vision. But the vision cannot be a reality until we have enough faith and love in the word that produced the thought, and the thought that produced the idea, that the idea produced the vision. So we are coming alive today because the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan has faith and love in the word that the Honorable Elijah Muhammad gave him, that is making a whole nation come alive today. And black people all over the world are connecting into the vision and the idea that white folks and the rulers and the powers today are afraid of. That man is none other than the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan. Leadership with an idea, with vision. All praises due to Allah. Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar. All praises due to Allah. All praises due to Allah. All praises due to Allah.
In the name of Allah, the Beneficent, the Merciful, the one God to whom all praise is due, the Lord of the worlds, who came in the person of Master Farad Muhammad, to whom praise is due forever. We thank him for his coming and for his raising up in our midst a divine leader, teacher, and guide, his messenger, the Messiah, the Most Honorable Elijah Muhammad. I greet all of you, my dear brothers and sisters, with the greeting words of peace. We say it in the Arabic language, Assalamu alaikum. I'm very thankful to Allah for his mercy and blessing to us to enable us to meet today. And we thank him for bringing us safely to Africa and returning us safely home with a marvelous experience that those of us who were blessed to go and those who were blessed to stay and see it by satellite have been raised several degrees by the experience. I thank Almighty Allah, Master Farad Muhammad, for permitting me to share in the honor of fulfilling the vision of so many great men. Starting at the turn of this century with the Honorable Marcus Garvey, W.E.B. Du Bois, Noble Drew, Ali, the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, his student Malcolm X, and others who envisioned black people in America returning to Africa. As we said 2 weeks ago, that vision did not start with Marcus Garvey. That vision was given birth to by the word of God found in what the prophets spoke of our coming or being brought into America, a strange land among a strange people to be made slaves. And God's word declared that we would suffer and be afflicted in America for 400 years. God's word also foretold that at the end of that 400 years, he would come and judge the nation that we would serve. And afterwards, it said, we would come out with great substance and go to our fathers in peace. In peace. Beautiful scripture. So God made the prophets to write what we have now fulfilled. We were brought to America in chains. We have suffered and been under affliction for 400 years. The good news is God is not to come. God has come. And he has come in fulfillment of the word that he caused to be spoken by his prophets. And America is now under divine judgment. Four great judgments are afflicting this nation. As we speak, rain, hail, snow, earthquakes, and many other related plagues are tearing America up in fulfillment of prophecy. America cannot escape her destiny. Neither can you or I escape ours. Now think of the words. After we had suffered 400 years, God would come. How are you going to know God came? You would see the judgment of God taking place, and you would hear the judgment of God coming out of the mouth of one of the slaves. Judgment only means that God has rendered a decision, and it is irrevocable, irreversible. It is as sure as the reality of God Himself. And that decision is that you and I will not be integrated into America. I'm going to say that again. This is for the integrationists. And I don't want to bust your bubble. But I do want to pierce it so you can see the fruitlessness of your labor to be joined on to your enemy. I'm going to say it again. It is not God's intention or will for you and me to be integrated into a people whose time of judgment has arrived. It is not God's will that you be integrated into the world of the white people. That's not God's will. I know it's yours. I know that. We don't want to leave white people. I can understand that. What slave wants to leave his master? But when you become free, you want to get free from that which has oppressed you. So it is the will of God that we be separated from our enemy. Look at the words. And afterwards, after the judgment starts taking place, afterwards shall they come out. But they're not coming out empty-handed. They shall come out with great substance. And they're not just going to come out with great substance. They're going to come out and go. Go where? Go to their fathers. In peace. Why did it say in peace? Because in our sojourn, we have been so confused. Confused about God, confused about the devil, confused about heaven and hell, confused about the reality of our lives. We're just confused, and there's no peace among us. But the scripture says we shall not only come out with substance, but go to our fathers in a state of peace. That means we will have made peace with God by surrendering to His will. We will have made peace with one another by acting in accord with God's laws that make brother and sister to enter into a peaceful condition with one another. So when we go, we don't go confused. We don't go unrighteous. We go home in peace. And guess what? That's exactly the way we went. We came out with substance. We didn't go back playing the fool. We didn't go back acting a fool. We went back with substance. And the greatest substance of all is knowledge, wisdom, and understanding. It's better than gold and silver, because you can't protect gold and silver with foolishness. You can only protect gold and silver and material things with value that is beyond gold and silver. And the value that is beyond gold and silver, of course, is knowledge, wisdom, and understanding. Well, we went back and we were warmly received by His Excellency the President Jerry John Rawlins, the President of Ghana. And when you get your latest copy of the Final Call newspaper and you're able to see the beauty of the President, the openness of his heart to receive his brothers and sisters home, the beauty of your African brothers and sisters crying out to us in the language Akwaaba, welcome, welcome home. The prodigal son had come home. Well, today I want to talk a little more about what my dear helper and assistant minister Ismail Muhammad touched on. Vision. Brothers, it is a great blessing to be able to see. Jesus opened the eyes of the blind. He gave back to people the gift of sight. Vision is the faculty of sight. It is unusual competence in discernment or perception. That goes beyond looking at a thing. It is looking beyond a thing, looking into a thing, so that you have an unusual competence in the ability to discern what others miss. Webster says that a vision is a mental image produced by the imagination. Ah, it's deeper than that, Mr. Webster. He did the best he could. Vision has at its root, as we said on Xavier's Day, an idea. An idea is a well-developed thought. You know, in the comic books, whenever somebody had a brilliant thought or idea,
they would put over the head a light, a bulb. That said, light got turned on in the guy's head. He saw something. He had an idea. But he really didn't have an idea. He had a thought. Because ideas are different from thoughts. Ideas, like thoughts, exist in the mind, potentially or actually as a product of mental activity. You can't have an idea or thought if your mind is not active. Brain waves on a machine that scans the activity of your mind, of your brain, shows an electrical energy in the brain that says, this is alive. Electrical energy in the brain allows the brain to do what the brain is designed to do. Create thought. Create image. Create pictures. Listen. Once you have a thought, that is a concept. When you say, sister has conceived, what do you mean? Sister has conceived. What do you mean? She's pregnant. Right? Conception is not baby. The conception has all the necessary ingredients to make the baby. But now it needs a period of gestation and growth in the darkness of the womb so that conception becomes a fully developed child, baby, fetus. When thought germinates in the mind, if you don't continue to think on the thought, I want you to hear me. If you don't continue to think on the thought, then the thought without more thought only is a thought that comes and goes. And you will say when somebody else comes up with the thought, but thinks on the thought, they stole my idea. They stole my stuff. They making the money and I ain't got none. Dirty low down thief. Wait a minute, fool. You don't have any corner on thought. You don't have any specific corner on imagery. Many of you have good thoughts, but you do nothing about what you think. So the thought was an opportunity that you blew because you didn't do by the thought what you should have done. You got to think on the thought. Thank you. You have to think on the thought. And thinking on the thought is feeding the thought. Then the thought develops into an idea. And that idea has with it a plan, a scheme, a method of fulfilling and concretizing what was a mental image that had potential, but now you want to actualize what you have envisioned. But if you even develop the idea or the thought into an idea and still will not work the idea, then God will give the idea to somebody else who will fulfill the idea and fulfill the vision brought by the idea. Now, let's go on. You all right? Now, my dear brother minister Ishmael, you really taught my subject this morning in 5 minutes, and I'll probably have to learn how to do that from you. I'm not going to keep you long, but I am excited by the vision. Now, beloved brothers and sisters, listen. After the thought brings up a concept you've conceived, most people talk the thought, and the thought gets lost. It's like showing the baby before the baby is a baby. Who wants to see a clot but an abortionist? And most times we get a thought, we speak it before we think on the thought. Get it developed. And it must develop in darkness, like the womb of the female, the womb of the mind. Develop your ideas. Then develop the method, the plan of execution. The idea will bring up a picture of the completed thing. The picture is in your brain. You can draw it on a piece of paper so that you can keep the vision before your eyes. But putting it on paper isn't actualizing the vision. The vision is only actualized when you bring it into concrete reality. How do you bring it into concrete reality? First, without faith, you can't work the vision. Even if you see it, you gotta now believe that you can bring it. Believe. Not only believe in God, but believe in yourself. Believe that you can do what you envision that must be done. But belief alone is not of any value unless belief is translated into practice or work. And it is belief joined by work that concretizes vision. Now, my subject today is belief in Allah. Belief in Allah. What is the problem with our lack of productivity? What is the problem with our lack of doing great exploits? Why haven't we conquered the country already after 60 years? of having the Word of God in our midst. What has slowed us down? It is lack of belief in Allah. Most of you believe in what you can see, especially you college people. No, I want you to talk to you college people, because college people generally don't accomplish much. Farrakhan, please. I'm not knocking that wonderful degree that you have or are striving for. But beloved family, look, college was never set up so that you could be set up with the needs of a people. College just wasn't set up for that. College was set up to train you to think in a certain way that would be beneficial to the architects of the philosophy that guides education. When I was with Barbara Walters, Barbara said to me, or Miss Walters rather, we didn't get on a first name basis. Miss Walters said, a Mr. Walter Annenberg had donated $50 million to education. And she wanted me to acknowledge the tremendous gift of $50 million to education. And if you didn't have the power of discernment, you might say, what a wonderful thing. Oh, $50 million. But what is $50 million to preserve your power and control over your world? If I spend $50 million on an education that trains the populace according to a certain idea that I am at the root of and am the prime beneficiary of, then you can't say I am a philanthropist. I am a realist who sees my world coming down because my idea is being challenged, so I want to sink more money into making more slaves to my idea. My dear educated brothers and sisters, when we are educated by our former slave masters, their idea is for you to envision their world. Take their vision for your sight. Then use the faculties of your mind, your intelligence, your gifts to support that vision that their education brings up in your mind, and it makes you a slave to their world. What is their world? Their world is governments, nations, systems, education, jurisprudence, social system, political system, economic system. So they lock us in to their world so that your talents, your gifts, build their world, support their vision, uphold their ideas at the expense of your own suffering people. And for upholding their ideas and their vision, they give you a salary. Well, they should give you something for betraying yourself and the desires of your own people. You ought to be paid well for that. Huh? So you say, I have a $50,000 a year job. Doing what? Upholding a vision that is not yours. Lending yourself to an idea that at the root of it is the supremacy of white people over all dark people on the earth. Ain't nothing but the truth, brother. Whether you are a doctor, a lawyer, a teacher, an engineer, a chemist, a social scientist, a psychologist, a carpenter, a plumber, an architect, your skills are utilized in their world to promote their vision. So when you see brothers and sisters on television selling products, you say, isn't it wonderful? Look at Michael Jordan selling Nike and getting millions of dollars. For who? He ain't building nothing for you. He ain't not even thinking about building a world. He's thinking about how well he fits into the world of his oppressors. And you admire the way he fits because you have no vision. You are a spiritually blind, deaf, and dumb people. You need Jesus to give you sight again. It's true. Whoever you admire in the political sphere, whose world is this? They ain't politicking in their world. I'm State Representative so-and-so. I'm running for mayor. I'm running for governor. Governor of what? Governor? We had our first black governor in Governor Wilder. He's a wonderful brother, a brilliant man. But governor of what? Of your world? Of his vision? Of his reality? No! No! He's working to uphold their vision. We've had wonderful mayors in Atlanta, Georgia. Mayor Maynard Jackson. The Reverend, Andrew Young. These two wonderful mayors have made Atlanta into a world-class city. We applaud them. But they built on a vision that is fulfilling the vision of white people. For black people in Atlanta are going backward, not forward. We had Mayor Washington here. He did a good job. But look at the condition that black people live under. Where's your vision? Who is gonna see for your black self? leaders are blind. Your leaders are bankrupt. Your preachers have no vision.
God said, after our 400 years, he would come. Oh, wow, brothers and sisters, what wonderful news and hope for a slave that God will come, not to the master, but to the slave. God is coming. Oh, what a joy. He's coming. Well, what is he coming to do? Say, hey, baby, I'm here. I'm God. Ain't you been waiting on me? God comes to give you a word. God comes to give you a word that contains light, life, and power. When God's word enters your mind, a light comes on. That light and the word of God in a well-developed plan, scheme, methodology called God's plan for your salvation, for our deliverance from our oppressor. It is not a thought, it is a well-developed idea that embodies a plan, a method, and a program. Program, a plan, a method that will lead to your coming out with great substance. Coming out of what? Coming out of the mind of your oppressor. Coming out from under the power of his vision and his idea of white supremacy. Come out of her, my people. Not integrate into the idea that destroyed you. Come out of her, that you be not partakers of her sins and her plagues. For her sins have reached unto heaven. Well, 60 years ago, Master Farad Muhammad, 64 years ago, pardon me, came. It says, the light shined in the darkness, but the darkness comprehended it not. He was a man with a word. He brought light, but our minds were so darkened we couldn't comprehend the light. He came unto his own, but his own received him not. God, what are you gonna do? How are you gonna make your light known in a place of darkness? He said, just as I raise clouds by the sun and the moon and their interaction with the waters of the earth, drawing the waters up from the earth in a fine mist that the naked eye can hardly detect. And then that mist forms into a cloud. And that cloud is borne on winds. If it is a warm
wind or current of air, when the cloud gets heavier than gravitation, it distills back to the earth in the form of rain or water. But if a cold current touches the cloud, when the cloud gets heavier than gravitation, she distills back to the earth in a fluffy form that is called snow, or an icy form that is called sleet or hail. Just as the power of the sun and the moon work on the waters of the earth, so the power of God's presence, the sunlight of God's presence, working on the moonlight of the prophet's words of his presence, it brings up a servant and raises him up among the people and fills him with divine wisdom until he becomes heavier than gravitation. Everywhere the servant goes, he's heavy. He's full of wisdom. And when he rains on you, you see a vegetation coming up in accordance with the majesty of the rain. Moses is called Moses because he's drawn out of water. Moses came up out of water like clouds are drawn up. And he was filled with divine wisdom. And everywhere the winds of opposition and hostility caused him to move, he dropped water on the dry, dead earth of his people. And after a while, you saw converts coming up to the Word of God with a new vision that far outstripped and encompassed Pharaoh's vision. Started to undermine Pharaoh's idea and close down his vision so that those that see may go blind and that the blind may now see. That's how you know that Jesus is in the world. They say he was talking to the wicked. And they said that they saw. He said he came into the world that those who say they see may go blind. And those who have no sight, that they may get sight. But what does that mean? That means that the more you work the idea of God, his vision becomes the vision of those affected by his word and his idea. Then even as that vision begins to close out our sight on the world of our oppressor and opens up a new world vision, so does it close down the sight of the enemy of that vision. And you see the enemy stumbling where yesterday his move seemed to be so fluid and perfect. You see him tripping over little things because God is taking his vision away. Sister, I want you to move that camera so that the people behind you can see. Thank you. Brothers and sisters, when God comes, he comes to give you his sight. He can't give you his sight until he gives you his light.
and his light comes in his word. But now, after you hear the word, you have a responsibility to respond to the word. Now, you can hear the word and say, oh, I don't like this. This Negro talking about coming out that I've been fighting all my life to get in. And he talking this come out business. I believe he's crazy. I believe he's a fool. This is the way the people talk about their prophets and their messengers. He's crazy. And they're asking us to come out just as we were looking like we was getting in. This fool. So you become a disbeliever. You had a chance to believe, but because your desire was to be with your enemy, your desire was to be accepted by your enemy, your desire was to marry into the family of your enemy, your desire was to be honored and respected by your enemy, then that desire caused you to stick your fingers in your ears when you heard a word that brought up a vision that would take you out of the idea of your enemy. So it begins to divide the people, believer, disbeliever. The disbeliever says, oh, I went down to the mosque. I heard them crazy people. I ain't going back there no more. Them people think they gonna build a world. Now you know them niggas is crazy. Why are we crazy? Didn't we help build a white man's world? You mean you can't build a world for yourself? You built one for somebody else, but don't have no heart to build one for yourself, even if God is at the root of it? You say, well, I don't want no God if he's gonna separate me from my white folks. Some of the old slaves thought like that in the time of Moses. We don't wanna go out. Go out where? Into the wilderness? Hell no. I ain't going out there with that crazy Moses. Well, now, that's the disbeliever. So the disbeliever ain't coming out with great substance. The disbeliever can't get a grip on substance. He continues, she continues to work the idea of the oppressor. And you get little pittance, you know, like a little crumbs from the master's table. He give you that. But then he disrespects you. Here you are in corporate America, the vice president, senior executive vice president of latrine cleaners. With a degree in engineering. And you're developing flush techniques. Just a little fun, that's all. My point, brothers, sisters, is this. You have good paying jobs, some of you. And you think that's real job security. There ain't no job security in this world. This world is going down and going down fast, man. Anytime these blue chip stocks, these blue chip companies are laying off thousands of workers,
That should be a sign to you, man. There ain't no future in a ship that got holes in it. You see the rats running, you still gonna hold on. I know Massa gonna bail this one out. No, even if you the engineer, he ain't gonna bail this one out. And you that have hope in his world, you will see your hope gradually extinguished. And if you don't have another vision that will give you hope of something better, then as he fires you after you work for 25 years, he said, I'm sorry, I got to downsize. Meaning I got to get rid of excess weight. My company's sinking. That's what it means. You are excess baggage. Meaning I got to get rid of excess weight. My company's sinking. That's what it means. You are excess baggage. You out of here. Then you say, well, why they do this to me? I've been so faithful. Yes. To somebody else's vision. And now that another vision is interfering with his vision and his sight, he's closing down. God is closing his shop to force you out. Then when you get out with no vision, you feel a sense of loss. You know, I ain't got no job. I got all these babies. What am I gonna do? Somebody gives you the bright idea. Sell these drugs. Let's carve out some drug territory, get some guns. And you ain't got no vision. You can't see beyond the reality of drugs. And where there is no vision, we are perishing. Now our men and our women being eased out of these high places, you're hopeless, filled with stress and anxiety, filled with disease, seeking pleasure in strange, inordinate ways. So if AIDS don't get you, syphilis, gonorrhea, herpes, simplex 1 and 2, getting you, cancer, getting us, tuberculosis, getting us, chronic liver disease from over drinking, getting us, lung cancer, cirrhosis of the liver, getting us, stroke, heart attack. Why are you suffering like this? High blood pressure? Because you're filled with anxiety. Because your vision is dark and dim. Your world coming down. You see loss all around you, and you don't have any competing reality to put your confidence in, to put your trust in. And so our families are falling apart. Our neighborhoods have turned in on themselves. And we have become totally self-destructive because we're disbelievers in God and in his coming and in his vision. Now, what word did he give Elijah? He raised a man for us. He always raises a man and a woman too. God raises women to do great things for him, but his prophets, the major ones for the most part, have been men, but there have been great prophetesses. Oh yes, it's right. We don't care nothing about the gender of his servants as long as they bring the word. You can't say to God, don't send me a woman. Go back. Tell God, send me a man. I can't listen and follow no woman. You're not following her gender. You're following the word of God and the vision of God embodied in that gender. Well, now let's go back. He raised a man. This time it's a man. The major figure is a man. The Bible calls him Elijah. The Quran calls him Muhammad. The New Testament calls him Jesus. All of it's the same person. Listen, listen, listen. Listen. Elijah, look at the words. Behold. Stop. Look. Listen. Behold. Before that great and dreadful day of the Lord, I, God, will send you Elijah the prophet. And he will turn the hearts of the children to their fathers, and turn the fathers' hearts back to the children, lest I come and smite the earth with a curse. This prophecy is in the book of Malachi, and Malachi means my messenger. And the book says he will have healing in his wings. You don't expect a man to come flying in on you, do you? Maybe that's why some of these false prophets put on capes and look like they fly. They've read and seen too many Batman and Superman and Captain Marvel movies. He comes on the wings of knowledge. An open book is like wings. He brings you the wings of knowledge, but the knowledge that he brings, it has healing in his wings. That's the way the Bible closes, talking about Elijah. Then the New Testament opens up telling you the genealogy, not of Elijah, but the genealogy of Jesus. Look at the words. And a virgin shall conceive and bring forth a child. And his name shall be called Jesus. And he will save his people from their sins. Oh, that's heavy. The Old Testament closes, Elijah's coming. He's going to have healing in his wings. He's going to turn the children back to the father and the father to the children. Here comes Jesus. Coming from the Father. Lord have mercy. Just look at it. And he has a plan of salvation of the people that have been oppressed under Satan's domination. And he's going to turn your heart, the children, back to the Father. Master, teach us how to pray. Our Father, somebody turned. Somebody got turned. And that man is called Jesus. And you say, praise his name. Because Jesus, the name Jesus, means the justifier. He justifies your belief in God more than any man that ever walked before him. Jesus, the justifier of faith. Jesus. The healer. Jesus, the teacher. Jesus, the comforter. Jesus, the savior. Jesus, the restorer. Jesus, the deliverer. Jesus, the king. Jesus, the conqueror. Jesus, God in person. Look now, ain't that who we need? Don't we need Jesus? Who you looking for? You looking for that pale-faced white boy that they told you was Jesus? They lied. Oh, wait, my Christian friends, don't cuss me. Don't get mad at me. Don't spit on me. Listen. The prevailing vision of this world is white supremacy. That's the idea that runs the vision. The vision is that all darker people will submit to white rule. And the best way to do it is to trick you in religion. Bear with me. Come on, Christians. Don't you back out on me now. Look. How do they trick us in religion? All they did was take the vision of Michelangelo. He painted Jesus as a white person. And then all our needs are to be sufficed by God in Jesus. You don't have one need that Jesus can't suffice. But what the enemy did, he made Jesus in the image of himself, your slave master. So the subtle message is that all that you want, all that you ever hope for, will come from white people. And this is why you don't drive by and shoot in Naperville. You ain't drive by shooting in Cicero, in Skokie, in Winnetka, in Glencoe. Not you. You ain't got no courage to drive by up there and shoot, because you would be shooting Jesus people. And you know you can't shoot white people. But you can shoot a nigga all day long, because you ain't shooting nothing. A nigga ain't nothing. He don't look like Jesus, the nappy-headed scoundrel with his thick lips and his broad nose. He don't look like my savior. So y'all wash me white as snow. Y'all fix me. I want to be more and more like Jesus, meaning not that I want to be more and more righteous. Hell no, you ain't striving for no righteousness. You striving for more and more whiteness. I want to talk like white people. I want to walk like white people. I want to act like white people. I want to be a freak like white people. I want to have orgies like white people. I want to walk my dog like white people. Take my poop scoop like white people. I don't want to be no nigger. I hate the day that my mother made me black. Thank God for Revlon and bleaching creams. Thank God for skin whiteners and hair straighteners. And thank God that I can even buy a pair of blue eyes now. I don't have to be a bone blue-eyed. I can buy them. You sick as hell. Been turned into a fool. Go all over the world fighting for your enemy and won't defend your own mother, your own wife, your own daughter. Won't defend yourself. You lay down like a coward. When you see the Son, you see the Father. For the Father is in the Son, and the Son is in the Father, and the Father and the Son are one. So they paint the Son white, which is giving you the subliminal message that God is white. The angels are white. The prophets are white. Well, how did you get black?
Well, you see, it's difficult to explain. I was cursed black. My blackness is somewhat of a divine curse. I thank God that my mother had relations with a white man so that I could be born half white. I couldn't get all the way, but I was trying.
Just look at the psychological damage done to you and me over the color question. All because they painted Jesus falsely. Now, none of us in this room would mind if Jesus were in fact white, because it ain't his color. It's what's in Jesus from God that is what we want. It ain't his color. But evidently, color meant something to white folks, because they knew the word and altered it. The Bible said he had hair like lamb's wool. Feel what you got on top of your head. That's wool, doctor. Ain't it wool? And then they didn't even say he was light skinned. They said his feet were like burnished brass. He was a man of color. He's not a man that lived 2,000 years ago. The man that lived 2,000 years ago was a sign of the one that would come at the end of the world of the white man. I wish I had a blackboard. You know, we got to get a blackboard. Because I got to write sometime. No, don't bother now. Don't bother now. It's too late. But every teacher needs a blackboard. Look, where is the mention of Elijah? Malachi, 4th chapter, from the 4th, 5th, and 6th verses.
chapter from the 4th verse to the 6th verse. Listen. Elijah and Jesus is one and the same. Elijah, Jesus, and the Muhammad of the Quran are one and the same. You got a Jesus 2,000 years ago, a sign. A Muhammad 1,400 years ago, a sign of Muhammad the Messiah, Muhammad the Mahdi, that would come at the end of the world of this old vision and old idea. Muhammad the praised one, Jesus the praised one, Elijah, meaning God, 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 my God. Man, brothers and sisters. Now, the book Malachi means my messenger. When should we expect him? In the 4th chapter. The 4 means 4,000 years from his prototype. Who is the prototype of the messenger? Moses. Moses came in a land of bondage, not to integrate the children of Israel, but to bring them out. Remember the words, after 400 years, I will come and judge that nation, and afterwards you shall come out with great substance and go to your fathers in peace. So Moses is the prototype. Both the Bible and Quran tell you that the last man would be a man like Moses. He would have to be a man in a strange land among a strange people. He would have to be a man coming up out of bondage. Jesus was not a man in bondage, not the one 2,000 years ago. Talk to me. Muhammad of 1,400 years ago was not under no wicked king like Pharaoh. Talk to me. Sorry about that. They were signs of a man that would come in the last day. The first 4,000 years from Moses. The second 400 years after they had been in bondage. The 6,000 years from the making of the enemy race of people. You should look for my messenger, Elijah, Jesus, Muhammad. Look for him. Now, what time is it? What time is it? What time is it? We are 4,000 years from Moses, and we have lived in America under bondage 400 years. We are 6,000 years from the making of Adam or the beginning of the white race. So we are at the end of our time of bondage, and we are at the end of their time of rule. So now God has come, and we should look for Elijah, we should look for Jesus, and we should look for Muhammad. What will Elijah do? He will turn the hearts of the children back to their father. Elijah is an axis upon which the people turn back to God. Jesus is a man who comes from the Father. The Father sends him. The Father makes him. And he brings forth a people that bear witness of the Father. He brings forth gods. He brings forth not prophets, but gods. That's why Solomon, who was the wisest man of the Old Testament, Jesus said, Solomon, in all his glory, was not arrayed as the least of these Jesus' followers. Are you a follower of Jesus? No, you are not. Where's your wisdom? What have you built?
nothing. Sorry about that. You're not wiser than Solomon. If you had the wisdom of Jesus, Solomon would sit at your feet. You would have to sit at Solomon's feet, not me. Solomon would be right there in the front row. Solomon would be getting his ex. Okay. Now. Time to go. I'm sorry. I have to finish this real quick. Now, Elijah, Jesus, Muhammad, all the same person. Now, beloved, he's going to be a black man. And if he comes to save a people oppressed and in bondage who are black, and the scripture says in the book of Deuteronomy, I will raise up, God talking to Moses, from among their brethren one like unto you. Talking to Moses. He says, I'm going to put my word in his mouth, and he shall speak unto them all that I have commanded him. Jesus said the same thing. That I hear, that shall I speak. He couldn't speak ahead of God. He only spoke after God spoke. This Quran was a revelation of God speaking to Muhammad through Gabriel, and Muhammad speaking only after he heard what God had to say. These are signs of a man who would come up from among you. Yes, you are going to produce Elijah. You are going to produce the Jesus. You are going to produce the Muhammad. And the vision, the idea, the word would come first to you. Jesus said, I thank thee, Father in heaven, for keeping these things from the wise and the prudent man and revealing them unto babes. Now, the concluding thought is this. Once you hear the word and meet the man and the word are one. But the man, understanding the man, is the key to unlock the word. You can't take the word and leave the man. You gotta take the man who brings the word and then study the man, for the man is the word in action. And therefore, when you study the man and feed on the word, then the love that you have in your heart for the man is the key to unlock the power of the word. The word is light. Listen, in the Quran, it says, Allah is the friend of those who believe. He brings them out of darkness into light. So belief is compared to light. Now the word of God is light. When you believe in the word, that is light upon light. I'm going to say it again. The word is light. Faith in the word is also light. If you hear the word, you are also receiving light. But if you don't believe,
then you can't open the power of the word that you're receiving. It can't benefit you because you don't believe. If you believe, then there's a tendency to carry into practice your faith. So faith is light upon light, which magnifies the power in the word and gives the believer the power of his faith and the power of the word. And the power times the power is the ability to do the work that God has put upon us to bring into reality the vision. What is the vision? What is the vision? Y'all all right?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
I am too. I feel very excellent. I was so full when I came here today, because I don't come out unless Allah gives me something to give to you.
Yes,
sir. And when he gives it to me, I come out and share it with you. But this is the critical part of the lecture. Now all of that you heard is wonderful, it's nice, it may be palatable, but you are not going to benefit. You, none of you. You're not going to get any benefit from hearing it. The benefit comes when that word enters your heart and you believe in it, then that faith is a light upon the light of the word. The word contains power, but faith unleashes the power in the word. Faith unleashes the power in the word. Now, what is the vision? Jesus brought with him a kingdom. His kingdom was not of this world. Isaiah the prophet said, "For unto us a child is born, a son is given, and a government." Not the U.S. government. No, not Haitian government, not Chinese government, French, Italian, British, Japanese. No, those are the governments of this world. Jesus was not of this world. He came bringing with him a government. The government was upon his shoulders. And the book said he would be called Wonderful, Full of Wonder. I mean, when you know him, you wonder. Oh, what a man. Like the scripture said, what manner of man is this? I mean, to behold a man of such exquisite beauty. It's full of wonderment. He'll be a wonderful counselor, meaning he got light of guidance. His guidance will give you the power of discernment, faculty of vision, sight. Wonderful counselor, the mighty God. If you say God, you're already saying he got force and power. But they put an adjective in front of God. God is already mighty, but then they call him the, not a mighty God, the mighty God. Oh, what are you talking about? I'm talking about a man
A man that got force and power, but he's called the mighty God because no other man in existence has power and force equal to his. Therefore, he's called the mighty God, the Prince of Peace, the everlasting Father,
and of the increase of his government of peace, there shall be no end. Well, brothers and sisters, I am here as a witness bearer of this Jesus.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
This Muhammad.
Yes.
This Elijah. And I can prove to you at no limit of time that I am his witness. And it ain't got nothing to do with vanity now. I'm just going to deal with raw facts. I am not the man, but I am the witness of the man. Not a witness, the witness. Well, listen. Now, Elijah Muhammad built something when he was among us. And what he built contained his vision for Black America. What do you envision, Elijah? We envision a world. At the root of that world is Islam. Islam is an Arabic word which means obedience to the will of God. Obedience to God's will is at the root of the idea that brings up the vision of a world in total obedience to God. We've got to survive in the white man's world. We're in it. We don't have to be of it, but we are in it. We definitely are in it. So, we don't have a hope in politics that politics is going to solve our problem. But politics will help. So if you want to run for political office, that's fine. But don't get bogged down in that, because that's the vision of his world. That's closing down. Your world is going to have politics. But it's not going to be the politics of this world, which is based on compromise and a whole lot of BS. You know what I'm talking about. Based on lies and chicanery. Looking out for the rich at the expense of the poor. That's not Jesus' world. Jesus loved the poor. Jesus worked for the poor. Jesus came out of the poor. This world's education ain't the right thing. We got to have a new education. This world's religion, forget it. Satan has corrupted the religion of the world, brother. Islam, Christianity, Judaism, Buddhism, I don't care what you call it. Satan got his hand in it. What God demands and what the scripture says, behold, I make all things new. Yeah. New government, new education, new religion, new science of economics, new science of health and medicine. It's a whole new world. That's the vision.
Yes,
now the question is, hey, all right, Farrakhan, this new vision, fine. Now, look, faith, I gotta have faith in order to bring it into reality. Faith is a confident belief in the truth, value, or trustworthiness of a person, an idea, or a thing, but it's a belief that does not necessarily rest on logical proof or material evidence. Now, most people, if it's not logical,
oh no, I've studied logic, and it doesn't seem logical.
No, brother. Logic is based on your ability to think on the material evidence and work within the scope of what you, in your mind, are able to agree is possible. Logic sometimes conflicts with faith. See, faith allows you to see beyond logic. Logic will restrict you to what you can logically see and understand. God don't deal with logic. His logic is far beyond our ability to logically understand his logic.
Wait a minute. Would you do me a favor?
Put yourself in Moses' shoes. And God tells you, hey, go to Pharaoh and tell him that I said, let you all go.
Logically speaking, this don't make too much sense.
Who gonna tell him sent me? Who should I tell him? You know, tell him I am that I am. Well, I'm more confused than ever now. But I'll go because you sent me, but I'm going like this. My heart pounding, my knees shaking. Pharaoh,
I was told to come and tell you, let the people go.
Pharaoh said, and who told you? Who is this God? I don't know no God other than me.
Well, he's I am that I am.
Can you imagine Pharaoh telling them, look, you nut. You better get out of here before I put something on you. Now this man go back to God. Pharaoh done got angry, put more stuff on the children of Israel. And he complains. He said, God, I went, did just what you told me to do. And now this man persecuting my people all the more. He said, go back to him.
Yes, sir.
Take this rod with you. Now look, God is building his servants' faith. He's building his servants' confidence. He's building his servants' courage. Because you're going to defy logic. You're going to defy conventional wisdom, and the world is going to say you are crazy. But if you believe in me and do like I tell you, you'll bring a new world into existence. My question is, do you believe?
Isaiah the prophet, he said they saw him coming. He said there was none to uphold him. So his own right arm, it upheld him. Traveling in the greatness of his own strength. That's power.
power, man.
And he comes alone. He didn't have no army with him. He came by himself.
Wait.
This is a powerful Christ, a powerful God. Then the scripture asks the question, to whom is the arm of the Lord revealed?
You ever notice a child, when you got a little muscle, the child said, let me see your muscle.
And you feel that, baby.
And when the child feels this big arm, he said, whoa! My daddy can beat your daddy.
And then when you tell him, baby, jump, he never jumped off the landing before, but he'll jump into your arms because you've shown him the arm of his father. To whom is the arm of the Lord revealed? Who knows God's power? When you know God's power and put your trust in God's power, you defy logic and you defy a world of scholarship and you bring in new logic, new scholarship. They have to rearrange themselves. Now I'm gonna prove myself. Y'all all right? Now I'm closing, but I don't want nobody to move. Because all my young brothers who today have a fetish or a fancy with guns, and you like the feel of steel in your pocket, and when you have your gun, you get this feeling of invincibility. The bigger the gun, the bigger your heart. What you say? What you say? You ain't got no heart, but your heart is in the gun. If you lose the gun, what happened to your courage? Oh, you don't have any. And who would defy a gun? This is logic. Logically speaking, when somebody got a gun at your head, brother, logically you're supposed to surrender. That's logic. Whoa, I can't deal with the heat of that gun. Oh, what you want? What you want? I'll give you what I ain't got. I'll find it if I ain't got it. Just put that gun down. But faith is a confident belief in the truth, value, or trustworthiness of a person, an idea, or a truth. A belief that does not rest necessarily on logical proof or material evidence. And it is that faith which gives light on top of light that then extrapolates the power of the word, and then a common man and woman can do uncommon things. And an ordinary person can do extraordinary exploits. A natural man can do supernatural things with faith in God and faith in God's word. Now, let's bring this to a conclusion. Joshua, the vicegerent of Moses, the one who took Moses' place
and led the children of Israel into the promised land. Look at the words of God. He said, there shall not any man be able to stand before you, Joshua, all the days of your life. As I was with Moses, so I will be with you. I will not fail you, nor forsake you. Look at the words now. He's telling Josh, the servant of Moses, Moses is dead now. Joshua got to take him in to the promised land. God got to let him know, I'm with you. Like I was with your father, Moses, I'm going to be with you. I will not fail you, nor will I forsake you. So be strong and of good courage. For unto this people shall you divide for an inheritance the land which I swore unto their fathers to give them. Only you must be strong and very courageous. In other words, the more you put your faith in me, the stronger you will become. The more faith you have in my word, the more courageous you become. And you've got to be strong and courageous for me to give you the land. Then, Joshua, you must do according to all the law which Moses, my servant, commanded you, and turn not from it to the right hand or to the left, that you may prosper wherever you go. Don't deviate from what Moses taught you. If you want to be prosperous, then he said, this book of the law shall not depart out of your mouth, but you should meditate on it night and day, that you may observe to do according to all that is written. For then you will make your way prosperous, and then you shall have good success. And then he asked him again, have not I commanded you? Be strong and be of good courage. Be not afraid, neither be you dismayed, for the Lord thy God is with you wherever thou goest. Look at those words. Think on them, feed on them in your heart. Now, over here in the book of 1 Samuel, listen, I just wanted to read a few things that I think you would appreciate, huh? Here, David is going out to fight Goliath. David tells the king, Saul, I'll go out and fight him. Well, who is this upstart? He says, well, if you're gonna go out, take my helmet of brass, take my coat of mail, take my sword. And David tries them on, and he says, King, I can't take these because I have not proved them. I haven't proved this helmet. I haven't proved this coat of mail, nor have I proved your sword. I have to leave these. And then he went to a brook and he picked up 5 smooth stones and he put them in a pouch and he went out to meet Goliath. And when Goliath saw him, he said, what is it? Am I a dog? You gonna send this out to meet me? Am I a dog or something? That little boy should be walking the dog. David reached in his pouch and took out one stone. But before he took that stone out, he told Saul, when Saul asked him, how are you going to do this? He said, God delivered the bear and the lion into my hands. I slew a bear and a lion. Surely he will be with me to slay Goliath. Now look at this. See, God is trying to show the servant, put your trust in me. Don't put your trust in anything else. Put your trust in me, man. I deliver a lion for you. I deliver the bear. I'm going to deliver this big giant for you. He reached in his pouch. He took out one stone and hit the boy in the head. And he fell. Then David went up, took his sword, cut off his head. His fame spread throughout the land. The Honorable Elijah Muhammad recited this to me one day. And he said, brother, do you know what those five stones were? I said, no, sir. He said, they're the five principles of Islam. They're the five pillars of faith. He said he only needed one stone to do the job. He said, and you know what that one stone was? I said, no, sir. He said, it is belief in Allah. That's all you gotta do to win, is believe in Allah and go forward. He said, Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, conquered all the tribes and was the most successful of any prophet that ever lived with that one principle, belief in Allah. There is no gun. There is no power bigger, greater than Allah. If only you would believe in him. If we only believe, then our belief would be light on the light that is in the word. Then that's power added to power, and it would explode you. The power that each one of you have within yourself is an untapped reservoir that you don't know how to use. And this is why you're sick and you're suffering and you're dying, because you don't know how to tap the power of your own soul. Listen to me, please. You have faith healers. I didn't say fake healers. I said faith healers. You have faith. The man says, do you believe? That's the first thing he asks. But if you don't believe, I can't act. Your belief is the power to heal yourself. Follow me now. Do you believe? And he said, by the power of the Lord Jesus Christ, you heal. Touch you on the head, you fall out. Whoa! I can walk. I can see. Walk. Sometimes it's fake, man. But sometimes it's real. The wings of healing and the wings of power come in on your, not mine, your faith. Jesus said, O ye of little faith.
If you had faith the grain of a mustard seed, you could say to the mountain, be removed, and the mountain would be removed. But you
don't even have faith the grain of a mustard seed, and a mustard seed is so small you can hardly see it. Brothers, sisters, if we developed faith, there is nothing that we could not accomplish in the name of God. You know what your problem is? You don't have even a worthy goal to strive after. I'm going to give you an assignment today. Here's an assignment. Is this something you want? Do you want something? Something that you want, but you have not been able to get it? Huh? Close your eyes. Do you see it? Can you see it? Now listen to me. If it's a car, close your eyes and see it. If it's a house, close your eyes and see it. Whatever it is that you want, first envision it. You got the picture. Do you see it? All right, now the question is, you have to claim what you see. I claim this. I claim it. I believe with all my heart in the name of God that I'll bring what is in my imagination into reality. But I can't just dream. I gotta go to work. I gotta go to work. And whatever you envision, say a prayer to the Lord of creation and ask him to bless you to bring into reality this little thing that you see and want. Now, be of good courage. Be strong. Be not dismayed. You can't have doubt and accomplish your vision. You gotta believe totally you can get it. You can bring it with God's help. And maybe some of you will have it next week. Maybe you have it 30 days from now. But when you get it, bring it. If it's a house, then you can't bring it. Just keep it. Bring a picture. And show others what your faith brought about. You see this universe out here? Everything you could imagine, God has already got it here. But if you don't draw on it, you can't get it. And if you don't believe that you can get it, you won't get it. Now, those of you who are ill and want relief from your illness, there is nothing impossible for God. Let me start right there.
Well, they told me my sickness is incurable. I know what they say. They say because their wisdom has run out. The Honorable Elijah Muhammad said to me that when Allah created the heavens and the earth from nothing, he destroyed the impossible. There's no such thing as impossibility. Once you say it is impossible for me to walk, it is impossible for me to see, it is impossible for me, you've closed the door.
But once you open up the realm of possibility, it begins faith, makes you defy logic.
Logically speaking, I don't think I will ever do. But we ain't talking about logic.
We're talking about faith that goes beyond logic. Now I want you to try this. Try it on a small thing until you get strong enough to try it on something bigger.
Yes,
and every time God makes you successful with a little thing, be grateful for the little thing. Then go on. Don't stop. Get a bigger goal and a bigger goal and a bigger goal.
Now, in my conclusion, the Honorable Elijah Muhammad departed from us. This February will be 20 years. He had built an $80 million empire from nothing. He had hundreds of mosques, thousands of believers, and his word had gone throughout the earth. The government of the United States, working through hypocrites and enemies, brought the nation to a naught. For all intents and purposes, the nation of Islam was gone. Your brother, who is a student of the great master teacher, Elijah, Jesus, Muhammad. But to be a student of Elijah, Jesus, and Muhammad is to be a master of Socrates, Plato, Galileo, Hegel, Freud, Jung. To be a student of Jesus is to be a master of this world. Just to be a, but you got to be a good student. Can't just be sitting in the class. A lot of you just go to school to take up space. Come to the mosque to sit down and be entertained with knowledge. And that ain't no good student. Because I'm going to get credit from God for teaching you. The question is, what credit will you get when God asks you, how did you respond to what you heard?
Yes,
say, well, I heard it. It was great. I really liked it. You should have seen how many times I jumped up and applauded. God, I jumped up 65 times, clapped my hands till my hands was red, went out of there feeling so good, and I went back to my room. And there was a mouse on the table. I kicked the mouse out and I ate the cheese. And I can't wait to go back to the mosque again so I can come back to that little dirty, nasty room I'm living in. Well, hell, if you're in Islam and all you got is a little dirty, funky room to live in, you just sitting there taking up space. You need to go on somewhere or get busy and do something with what you've been taught. Sitting around here with nothing in your pocket and claim to be with Elijah? Hell no. Running around trying to find a gun to defend you with? Because you got a dangerous assignment, you have no courage, no heart. You need a gun and you got God, but you forsake God and pick up a gun? Punk, die with your damn gun then.
Excuse me. I shouldn't use that kind of word.
But I get hurt
when you got all the power sitting around you and don't know how to tap into it because you're weak in faith. Don't send faithless men to do big jobs. You gonna work with black people? You better have some faith. You gonna work in a so-called gang-infested area? You better have some faith. You don't go to my brothers and sisters with guns. Go to them with God. You can't get me to put a gun on me. I bought two when I lost my mind. I did. I bought two guns. But I had really lost my mind. I lost my faith. That was a time that the Honorable Elijah Muhammad was gone, and I lost my faith, and I was living out in Beverly, and you white boys was brick batting my house. My granddaughter was just a baby then, laying on the floor, and they threw a milk bottle and brick in the window. But God protected her. She was in a ring of glass. But there was a field that no glass got in, and the glass didn't get in where she was laying. That let me know God was with her and with me. But I didn't pick up on the sign. I went and got me a gun. And after I bought the gun, this is the truth. I bought it out in a gun shop in Dalton, and they have a shooting range in the back, and this is the first time I ever fired a gun. PPK, I think it was. I bought my wife a Browning automatic, I think, or we was gonna shoot down on both. And I went in that back room, and they had this black image. I was supposed to blow that black image away. That was the target. The target wasn't white, it was black. They said, just squeeze. And I squeezed. And every time I squeezed, I really hit the target. But man, sweat started dropping out from under my arm like a faucet was running. I knew then that the gun was not for me. I'm like David, I ain't proved that. I ain't putting my confidence in that. I went to the police station. Said, where's the captain? Who wants to see him? Louis Farrakhan. I went in his office. I said, Captain? I said, some little white boys in the neighborhood throwing bricks in my window. I said, it seemed like you all know how to make examples of little black boys, but you don't know how to make examples of your own. So I went and bought me two guns. And the next little white boy that throw anything in my window, I'm gonna put a bullet in his. I wasn't quite as developed as I am now. This cat said to me, and if you do, we'll be coming after you. I said, you just have to do that. And I walked out of his office. Ain't another brick come near my window. I meant that I would have shot him. And when my granddaughter's mother was pregnant with her, some white boy threw her down in the snow. I put my gun in my pocket and went out. If I had seen him, I'd been in jail now. Because I don't buy nothing to play with it. Yes, sir.
I buy it, I intend to use it if it need to be used. That's intelligent. You don't buy a pot not to cook in it. A vacuum not to clean with it. So naturally, you got all these guns, brothers. You want to shoot something. And you don't want to shoot tin cans. You want to shoot empty-headed black folk. So you out here killing each other because of your romance with a gun. But the white man don't fear the gun, because he got something bigger. And I'm telling you, brothers, he has already laid the plan and is about to execute his plan. Did you see him on television last week? Police got shot in Aurora. And I heard the newscaster say, for the first time, the gangbangers are no longer just shooting each other. The gangbangers are now shooting officers of the law. 2 days later, some of our brothers in the Four Corner Hustlers, they came on TV showing the kind of weapons that they were trying to buy, pointing out a police station and a rocket launcher that the brothers were gonna blow up. You may laugh, but the white folk ain't laughing. The police are saying, we don't have the firepower to deal with the gang. Clinton went all around the country talking to police. The crime bill is to put more police on the street, build bigger prisons, and give them greater firepower. Go check out the National Guard armories and see what's sitting up in them armories for you, for me, for us. And if they come in the black community, even though they know that we don't carry no weapons, where do you think they're going to attack? They don't fear your guns. Because what they will do, they have these armored personnel carriers right now in the armories. And they'll bring helicopter gunships. They're not playing. And see, with you, you get this little feeling of invincibility because of the little 9mm you got, or your street sweeper or whatever. But when you see the stuff that they pull out on you, and they ain't coming first, they gas you first. Poor you. You got all this weapon and ain't got no protection, not even a gas mask. Ain't even got a supply of beans. So that if you can't go to the store, you can eat. This fella, when you get him upset, he's coming. And he ain't coming to play. And many of our politicians, they're out there calling for the National Guard. It isn't that they're bad. They just don't have the power of discernment. What the enemy has done, he's put us in such a state that we have driven our politicians and our leaders to their wits' end. They want to stop the killing. They don't know how. So they're begging the government, bring the National Guard, bring federal troops. And that's on the drawing board right now. Let me close by saying, 17 years ago, as a student of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, out of my love for him, I took up his word again. That word, which was light, life, and power, contain the idea, the scheme, the plan, the method, and the program of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad for the salvation of our people. There was only one other brother with myself and no money. What I needed to bring to the endeavor was faith. And faith defied logic. When I came to Chicago from New York City, and I decided to help rebuild the work of Elijah Muhammad, practically every leader in business, religion, and politics in this city, I visited them. And I asked them, could I get your blessings? I am going to try to rebuild the work of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad. Is not one of them from John Johnson to Father Clements to Reverend Jackson to Lou Palmer to George Johnson to the congressman, not Gus Savage, no, this was 17 years ago. What's his name? Metcalf. Thank you. Congressman Metcalf. I sat with him. And of course, they humored me, you know. Oh, this little kid. He's going to rebuild the work of Elijah. They didn't laugh in my face, but you could see, first of all, it was so strange that I would even come and ask for their blessings. But I was showing respect to the established leaders in the city of Chicago. I saluted the house. I greeted them, and they said, yes, come in. And I went to work. I crisscrossed this country, brothers and sisters.
Yes, sir.
Burn out the motors in my car.
Yes, sir.
Driving by myself. Me and my brother, Jibril, all over this country. In little hamlets and villages in Mississippi. Your brother went down there preaching. I mean, I must have preached in about 15 towns in Mississippi. And everywhere I went, somebody would come up to protect me and to believe. You see?
Yes, sir.
I had a vision.
Yes, sir.
And I had faith in the vision.
Yes, sir.
And I didn't go to sleep saying, Lord, make it so. I said, Lord, make it so, and went to work. And because I went to work on that vision, and others came bringing their skill to help me with that vision. Sister Tynetta Muhammad, Sister Evelyn Muhammad, Brother Minister Akbar Muhammad.
Yes, sir.
Several of them came. Brother Khaled. Brother Kareem in New York.
Yes, sir.
Pretty soon, the nation began to form again. I drove right by this mosque. I looked at it. I knew that one day we'd be back in here. And we started in a cellar and then in my basement. Huh? Then I got a funeral parlor. And we cleaned it up. But if you notice, I never put the name mosque on it. I called it the Final Call Administration Building. Because the only mosque that I had in mind was where you're sitting right now. And step by step, we worked the vision. The mosque came. The school came. Pretty soon, the Muhammad Speaks plant will be up.
Yeah.
The Salam restaurant will be up. We got the farmland back. Got the sales and office. But this is just a start. Now we went on to Africa. Now the kings and the rulers have caught the vision. Huh? No gun in my pocket. Just God in front of me. Because he said he would not forsake me. He would not fail me. So I have no other alternative but to put my trust in him. And I'm telling you, I am a witness of Jesus. I am a witness of Elijah. I am a witness of Muhammad. How so, Farrakhan? Elijah was to turn the hearts of the children to their fathers. Elijah Muhammad is our father. But hypocrisy turned us away from our father. And the scripture says, behold, Elias must first come and restore all things. Here he is. He's here in me. Elijah is present. He's alive. Wait a minute. All praise is due to Allah. Look. Is your heart turned back to your father?
Yes, sir.
Are you being restored?
Yes, sir.
Is your soul being restored?
Yes, sir.
Are you being led in the path of righteousness for his name's sake?
Yes, sir.
Yea, though you walk in the valley of the shadow of death, do you fear some evil?
No.
Has a table been prepared for you and me right in the midst of our enemies?
Yes, sir.
Then who is your shepherd?
No.
Our shepherd, and he's in me guiding you. If you would follow what I ask you to do, you'll be successful. I'm a witness of Jesus. Look at me. Behold the servant of God, in whom his soul delights. He's put his spirit in me. And now he's bringing forth judgment to the Gentiles. Look at what's coming out of my mouth and look at the effect of my word. I don't give speeches. Clinton gives speeches. Bush gives speeches. Jesse Jackson gives speeches. But Louis Farrakhan delivers the word of God, and that word transforms human life and brings about total change in people. I am a witness of Jesus. Your eyes. Were you seeing before you heard the word?
Yes, sir.
You got sight today.
Yes, sir.
Were you hearing? No, your ears are open.
Oh, yes, sir.
Were you speaking? No, the knot in your tongue got loose.
Yes, sir.
Huh?
Yes, sir.
You had a leprous white mind.
Yes,
how you doing today?
Yes,
you walked with a limp. You were paralyzed. Couldn't do nothing for yourself, but the word freed your hands. Who did you meet that saved you from your sins? You met Jesus. He was walking in me. I was blessed to raise you from the dead by Allah's permission. Yeah, you want to see Jesus? Look at your brother. He's in me. Who were the enemies of Jesus? It was the Jews, the scribes, the Pharisees, the Sadducees. Who are my enemies? Jews, the scribes, the Pharisees, look at their writings about me. What sin have I committed
that I am hated by white people. Look up at me, damn it. Don't look away. Behold the Lamb of God that taketh away the sins of the world. Be afraid. I am a witness of my Father, and I am his son. The Jews want me dead. Not all of them, some of them. The government don't like me. Some of my own black leaders are frightened of me, just like they were with Jesus. They come around my house in the dark like Nicodemus, but they don't want to walk with me in the light because they don't want white people to cut off their favor. But the white man can't cut off my blessings. Why should he cut off yours? If you had faith like I got faith, you wouldn't have to worry about your bread. You're just a group of cowardly people, faithless people. This beast wants to put me behind bars. They want to bring me before their courts. They may very well do that. I'll go like he went, but I'll be the winner. Not that I am the winner, God is the winner. And as long as I'm with God and God is with me, there ain't no weapon formed against me or you that will prosper. So you take that gun out your hand. Put it away. And pick up faith.
Yes, sir.
And put on the whole armor of God. Put on the helmet of salvation. Helmet is what protects your head. Put on the word. The word of God is a helmet. You don't need no brass helmet like Saul tried to give David. Huh? Put on the breastplate of righteousness. Because when you're righteous, any dart that comes your way has no effect because God is your shield and your buckler. He helps you to create an atmosphere that burns up foreign obstacle objects that come in your atmosphere like it is with the earth. Shod your feet with the shoes of the gospel.
Yes, sir.
What is the gospel? Good news.
Yes.
You scared to tell the people good news that God has come and chosen the foolish things of the world? He come to be our God and choose us to be his people? You afraid to say that? You don't want to openly confess God? Who came in the person of Master Farad Muhammad, a real live man? That's the gospel. But I'm telling you, brothers and sisters, you can't walk with me if you got the idea of harm and murder in your heart for your people. You're not with me. You have no right to kill no one that Allah has not ordered to be killed. We are so filled with a self-righteous hypocrisy that if we were judged like we tend to judge others, maybe many of us would be pushing up daisies. When you go among your people calling yourself a god. Call yourself a god and guard yourself against indecency and evil. You go out among the people and slip in and have sex with their little girlfriends. You take the good looks that God gives you. He cleaned you up from your wicked and funky expression. Now your eyes shine in this, shine in your skin, and you look better than your brothers who have not come to faith like you. Naturally, the young ladies will want you. You haven't got no strength. You slipping in and slipping out, committing fornication and adultery, and call yourself a Muslim. The people are looking at you, and they're saying these are some phony niggas. And what are you doing? You're bringing on yourself the wrath of the people because you are not righteous. You're perpetrating a fraud. You among the savagery of our people, they have guns. So you feel that God is insufficient for you, you gotta have a gun. The moment you pick up a gun, you invite that response to you. Elijah Muhammad never taught no such thing. Take the gun out of your hand. Put it out of your homes. Get it away from your children. And go armed with the righteousness of God. Do you know who these people are? In these projects on the west side, they're the people of God, brother. Crazy as they may seem, that's God's people. And if you go to them in the right spirit, not with no self-righteous hypocrisy and arrogance, like you think you're better than they are, when yesterday you were doing the same damn thing that they're doing today, don't you remember what God brought you from? They called us punks. That's what they called us. So what? If it moves you, maybe you are a punk. You can call me a punk all day long. It ain't gonna bother me because I know who I am. And I know soon they gonna find out. White man ain't afraid of punks. He's afraid of truth and men of God who got the courage to tell it. They're not afraid of you and your gun. They're afraid of me and the word of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad. They shut me out of London. Wouldn't even let the signal come down. Why? Who is Farrakhan? Is it the way I part my hair? Hell no. It's the word, man. The word that carries the vision and the idea of God that is closing down their world. You don't need no gun. You just need to arm yourself with faith in your God. Take up and put on the breastplate of righteousness and the sword of the Spirit. What is the Spirit of God? It is the energy of His life. And it is His love for His people. He came 9,000 miles to get us. He loves us. Do you love the people that God came to redeem? If you love them, why can't you suffer an insult? Why must you retaliate
for an insult. I've been insulted for 40 years. And those that curse me, I bless them. You didn't hear me? See, y'all talk about Jesus, but you scared to live Jesus' life. I know that his life is the only life that will redeem our people. You got to be able to take a lot to save our people. And if you so thin-skinned, what you doing with that long dress on? That Aunt Jemima thing on your head. Hey, please. You can't take that? Naturally, you don't like it. But can't you take it? Suppose they mocked your garment and you smiled at them and said, may God bless you to understand better. Yes, and kept on walking. They might say, that's a strange nigga. I cussed her and laughed at what she had on. And she smiled and told me how nice I looked. And she hoped that one day I would understand. You go knock on the door to sell the paper. Get that paper, shoot you. So. May God bless you. I hope you feel better. He behind the door saying, that's a strange response. He may open the door. Hey, you nigga with the paper. Man, look, I didn't mean that. I'll take that paper. I just wasn't feeling so good. Thank you, brother. I know. I sure hope you feel better. How much is that paper? Just a dollar. Here, take two. He feel bad. But if you said, what do you mean? Come out from behind that door. I'll show you what a nigga's like. You ain't no redeemer. You're a killer. You're hurting my work. You're not helping me. You're hurting me. Those are my people. Those are my brothers and sisters. I love all of them, no matter what their condition is, because God loves them all. I don't want to see you hurt. I don't want to see you wounded. But you said it, my prayer, my sacrifice, my life, and my death is all for Allah. Isn't that what you said?
Yes, sir.
But did you mean it?
Yes, sir.
So you can't take a little abuse from your people and their ignorance to redeem them?
Then the work and the spirit of the God and his Christ is not in you. You have never heard me plot, plan, or say nothing of evil against my enemies who are black. I take on them white ones.
Yes, sir.
But them black ones, and sometimes they worse than the white ones. And you know I'm telling the truth. But I just looked like I didn't hear it. And pray for my own people. Martin Luther King was right. He just practiced nonviolence with the wrong people. Somebody needs to preach nonviolence to black people for black people. We don't need to be violent and destructive of one another. You need to be forgiving and kind and loving toward
one another. I hope that today's lecture has helped in some way to make you see that Elijah, Jesus, and Muhammad are one. And the public needs to see Elijah, Jesus, and Muhammad in you. When you sit under this teaching and go out to your people, they should begin to see the birth of these three great men in one, in you. And if you understand these three, Muhammad, Jesus, and Elijah, and just begin to practice the teachings, you'll find yourself successful in what you attempt to do. Now, don't forget what I said about vision and belief, and then righteously working to fulfill your vision. How many of you saw something that you think you would like to possess? Would you raise your hands? You did? How many of you, after seeing it, believe that you can achieve it? Let me see your hands. All right. I'm going to give you a little time. Inshallah. I want to see, honest to goodness, how many of you achieve what you saw today, marshaling the strength of your mind and your own talent and focus on that object and get it without stealing.
Yes, sir.
Without lying. Uh-oh, I blew it then, didn't I? That brother had five bags of reefer. He was going, so many bags of crack. I said, oh man, Farrakhan, you done messed up my stuff. No, brothers, sisters, you don't need to do anything illegal to prove God in your life. God said be, and it is. And he never stole nothing, and he didn't borrow nothing. He just produced it. And you are from him. So if the more you steal, you kill your own creative mind. Don't even think about doing nothing wrong. Think about using the creative power of your mind, your faith in God, and your faith in the ability to bring about what you envision. Try it. Try it. And when you succeed, I wish you'd just let me know. If you don't come to the mosque, drop me a card and just say, I got it. And then move on to the next thing. And when you grow up in this, you begin to see how easy it is to do it. Then you start envisioning what God wants, the establishment of his kingdom on earth. And if we go to work, everywhere you look, we take over the schools. We can take them over. They're ours. Our money support them. Our little babies are in them. Let's take it over. They don't know what the hell they're doing. Let's show them what to do. Let's put God's vision in the school. Let the cracker tell you.
We can't have God in here.
When we take it over, God has taken it over. He come in the school in us. Isn't that right? Anytime you sending your child to a school that don't want God in it, we shouldn't want our children in it. If God ain't in it, we should come out of it. And when we go in it, let's bring God with us and establish God in the education. Let's take it over. We can take over our community. We ain't got to go nowhere. We just got to come out of their vision. Come into the vision of God. Thank you for listening, and may Allah bless you as I greet you in peace. Assalamu alaikum.
Thank you.
Thank you. Could you be seated for just a minute? I know it's late.
Boy, that Farrakhan, Lord.
Ishmael, you got to teach me how to do it in 5 minutes, brother. This wonderful son of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, he's growing so wonderfully, isn't he? I'm very proud, man. Very proud.
Yeah. Hosanna, Hosanna, my help is come. All praise is due to Allah. How many of you are here today for your first time? Never been to the mosque before. May I see your hands? Beautiful. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you for coming. Those of you who are here for your first time, how many of you believe that what you heard taught today, that it is the truth and is good for us as a people? Can I see your hands, please? Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you. Now, the last question that I want to ask you is very important, because while I was talking to you, another conversation was taking place between you and God. And sometimes when you hear a man speaking and he says things that illuminate the mind, another voice is saying something to you, saying, that's right. Whoa, this is what I've been looking for. Man, he's right on it. But it's a conversation between you and God. Now, usually when a pastor, preacher, teacher gets finished preaching, he's so happy when he makes an altar call. And if nobody comes, he's all upset. You know what I mean? I don't have anything to do with this part of it. Again, it's between you and God. But I would like to ask all those who are here for your first, second, or third time, who believe that what you heard taught is true, how many of you are ready to accept that truth and become a part of the Nation of Islam under the guidance of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad and unite with me to help bring about a vision of a whole new world encompassing government, religion, education, science, business, international trade, but all based on the Word of God? How many of you think you would like to be a part of that? Would you raise your hands, please? Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Now, sisters and brothers, we want to do this very, very quickly because I did stay a little longer than I had anticipated. All the brothers and sisters who would like to unite with us to carry out this vision, I would like to have the privilege of shaking your hand as a symbol of my uniting your hand with the handle of truth. I don't want anybody to get up just to come and shake my hand, because my hand is just like your hand. See? Ain't no different. And you got just as much power in you as God has demonstrated through me. You just need to know how to bring it out. Each one of you is a powerhouse. And I'm just hoping that we can inspire you through faith to activate the power of your own self. Then we can accomplish, like Marcus Garvey said, up you mighty race, you can accomplish what you will. All the sisters that want to unite with us, I want you to come, and all the brothers, sisters, you can come right down this aisle and around and let me shake your hand. All the brothers, come over to the center aisle and come right down and let me shake your hand. All the rest, just stay seated. It won't take but just a minute for me to shake their hands. Would you come down, please? Where are the cards? And what we're going to do is we're going to give every brother and every sister this card to fill out. And it states very simply that these brothers and sisters are going to pledge to strive to love their brothers and sisters as they love themselves. They're going to pledge to study to improve themselves spiritually, mentally, morally, physically, and economically for the benefit of themselves and their families. And they're going to pledge to strive to build schools and hospitals, housing, businesses, to buy farmland, and to enter into international trade and commerce for the good of themselves and their family and our people. And we're going to pledge to give of our time and our talent, our energy, and whatever we can spare of our finance to accomplish the above said. And I want you to take this card and fill it out and turn it in. And from that moment on that you take this pledge, you are a part of the Nation of Islam. You have brothers and sisters all over America and over a billion all over the world. So you're not joining, you know, a church or an organization. You're becoming a part of a whole world. Thank you. Let me shake your hands.
Let's hear it for our beautiful sisters and brothers that have come forward to unite with the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan and to join on to the Nation of Islam. Give your brothers and sisters a warm round of applause. Show them that you appreciate their stand. Show them in your applause that you love the stand that they're making this afternoon. All praise is due to Allah for the Honorable Elijah Muhammad and the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan for giving us this word this afternoon that we might save our lives and improve the quality of our lives. Keep your applause going. Let them know, these brothers and sisters that stand here, that come forward, let them know that you appreciate their stand this afternoon. Let's hear it for them, brothers and sisters. These are our future leaders of our people. All praise is due to Allah.
Go ahead, brothers and sisters, let them hear it all over Mosque Maryam. Give them a warm round of applause as our brothers come forward to shake the hand of our leader, teacher, and guide, the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan, taking a stand to unite our people in Chicago, all over Chicago, and in fact, the world today. Let us give them a round of applause and encourage them. Let them know they've made the right decision, and in fact, they've made it at the right time. Give them a big round of applause. All praise is due to Allah. Let us hear it as a few more of our beautiful sisters come forward to take a stand to unite with the Honorable Louis Farrakhan and the Nation of Islam. These are the helpers who will assist in the rebuilding work that you and I know we so desperately need.
Thank you, brothers and sisters, for a wonderful afternoon. I pray that Allah will bless each and every one of us to return safely to our homes, and that when you leave today, I hope that you will leave with a better spirit towards yourself and towards your family, towards your parents, towards your brothers and sisters. Go home and try to be better than you are now. Go home and try to be kinder to your mother, to your father, to your wives, to your husbands. Just try to do better, you know? And when you see somebody look nice, you don't have to be afraid, just tell them. And you don't have to have an ugly expression. You know, you ain't got no money, but you can be pleasant. You'll have some soon. Thank you for a wonderful afternoon. Brother Ismail Muhammad has something, just a few announcements to make. And I'm going to pray and hope that Allah will bless me to be with the FOI tomorrow night. I want to see all the brothers. All the brothers. You all are the backbone of the nation. And if you take up the wings of faith,
that's right.
I mean, there's nothing that we can't accomplish together. So tomorrow evening at 7:30, I look forward to seeing the men.
Yes, sir.
If you're able to come. May Allah bless you all. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Assalamu alaikum.
Thank you.
Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar.